Hello and welcome to The Chemistry Solution. This is Naming Ionic Compounds, and this is part two where we name compounds that include polyatomic ions. To review, ionic compounds normally consist of a metal and a nonmetal. They always, however, consist of a positive ion or cation and a negative ion or anion. Ions can be monatomic, which means they consist of single atoms, or they can be polyatomic, where you have two or more atoms that are covalently bonded together, and where the molecule itself has an overall charge, either positive or negative. Let's talk a little bit about naming cations. Normally, if cations are formed from nonmetals, they have the ending ium. And the most common nonmetal cations are polyatomic cations like ammonium or hydronium. If cations are formed from metals, they have the same name as the metal. Often metals really only form one type of ion, but some metals can form ions with different charges, and these are usually your transition metals and also lead and tin. In order to distinguish what charge the metal ion has, you use Roman numerals in parentheses after the name. You can also use the endings us or ic to distinguish the oxidation state of the metal. And I went over in more detail how you do this in the Ionic Compounds Part 1 video. Now let's talk briefly about naming anions. If you have a monatomic anion, you drop the ending of the element and you replace it with ide. So when oxygen forms a monatomic anion, it becomes oxide. And when chlorine forms a monatomic anion, it becomes chloride. The good news about polyatomic anions, and this holds true for polyatomic cations as well, is that their name is never changed. The bad part about this is usually polyatomic anions must be memorized. Here's a list of some common polyatomic ions. You can see that most polyatomic ions are anions, however, there are a few polyatomic ions that are cations. How much of this list you need to memorize really depends on your teacher or professor or the class that you're taking. In some instances, you'll be given at least a few of the polyatomic ion formulas and names. And maybe you'll even be lucky enough that you aren't required to memorize any of the polyatomic ion formulas or names. If you do have to memorize the names of polyatomic ions, I'm going to show you a little trick to help you with naming polyatomic oxyanions. So a polyatomic oxyanion would be a polyatomic anion that includes oxygen. These all have endings of either ate or ite. The ending 8 is given to the most common oxyanion of an element. The ending ite is given to the oxyanion of the element with the same charge but one less oxygen atom. If you have oxyanions of elements that contain more than two different numbers of oxygen atoms, you can also use the prefixes per or hypo to indicate even more oxygen than the oxyanion ending in 8, or even less oxygen than the oxyanion ending in ite. So let me show you how this works. If you know that the formula for NO3 with a charge of -1 is called nitrate, that means that the same oxyanion with one less oxygen atom would be NO2 with a charge of -1, and we would call that nitrite. So if you know the name and formula of one oxyanion of an element, you can infer the name and formula of another oxyanion with the same charge. Let's look at another example here. If I know that ClO3-1 is chlorate, then ClO2-1 must be chlorite. If I have even more oxygen than chlorate, which would give me a formula of ClO4-1, that becomes perchlorate, so use that per prefix. And if I have one less oxygen atom than chlorite, the formula for that would be ClO-1 with the name hypochlorite. So if you practice this a little bit, just knowing the name of one oxyanion in a series, you can figure out the names of the other oxyanions of that element. This will help you cut down on the memorizing a little bit, at least. If you're looking for tips to how to memorize some of these polyatomic ion formulas and charges and names, I have a couple things I'd suggest. The first is flashcards. That's a great way to help you memorize these, if that's what's required for the class you're taking. The other way, and it's probably even more effective than using flashcards, is just to practice naming lots and lots and lots of ionic compounds that have polyatomic ions in them. And you'd be surprised how quickly some of these polyatomic ions would become familiar to you. Okay, let's practice naming some ionic compounds that include polyatomic ions. Looking at the first formula, we have Ca3 and then PO42 in parentheses. The cation would be calcium, and it gets to keep its name because it's a monatomic cation. So you would have calcium, and then polyatomic ions never change their name. So you would have phosphate because PO4 is the phosphate ion. Moving to the next example, Al2 and then SO4 in parentheses 3. Again, you have a monatomic cation, so it gets to keep its name, aluminum. And then SO4 is the polyatomic ion sulfate. Again, unlike monatomic anions, where you change the ending to ide, if you have a polyatomic anion, it keeps its same name. So never change or alter the names of your polyatomic ions. Now would be a great time to pause this tutorial and try the last three examples on your own. Okay, looking at the third example, we have Mg and then NO2 in parentheses with a 2 outside of parentheses. Magnesium is a monatomic cation. It gets to keep its name, magnesium. And then NO2 is the nitrite anion. So be careful that you don't confuse the ites and the eights. So nitrite has the formula NO2 with a charge of -1. Nitrate has a formula NO3 with a charge of -1. That brings us to our next example. We have lithium because it's a monatomic cation, and then the group NO3, which is nitrate. So lithium nitrate. This last one is an example that throws people off a lot of times because they're used to seeing the polyatomic ions at the end of the formula because most polyatomic ions are anions. But remember, there are a couple polyatomic ions that are cations, and this is one of them right here, NH4, which is in parentheses 2s. So NH4 is the polyatomic ion ammonium. And then if we have a monatomic anion, we go back to our rules for naming binary ionic compounds. We would change the ending of the element to ide. So the name for this compound would be ammonium sulfide. What you've probably noticed here is that just like when you have binary ionic compounds, the names don't depend on the number of each type of ion. If you want a little more information about why this is, you should watch the tutorial on ionic compounds. We also discuss this a little bit in the naming ionic compounds tutorial part 1. Thanks for watching. We hope you enjoyed this tutorial. Look for naming ionic compounds part 3. Where we're going to do lots and lots of examples, binary ionic compounds, compounds that contain polyatomic ions, compounds where you need to use a Roman numeral in the name to indicate the charge of a metal. And we'll talk about how to tell the difference between these compounds and how to appropriately name each type. If you like these tutorials and there are others that you would like to see covered, please feel free to send an email to Missy, MISSY, @thechemistrysolution.com. Thanks again for watching.